Hi everyone, welcome back to my videos on discrete-time Markov chain. In the previous video, I showed you in a concrete example how we can find the stationary distribution. So that was just by using like the main theorem we saw in a previous video about stationary distribution by solving the system by P called Spy. Now, in today's video, I'm going to look at the particular example of doubly stochastic Markov chain. So I'm going to start with a general result by proving some theorem. The proof is pretty short to show you that indeed when the process is doubly stochastic, the algebra is much simpler than in the general case. I'm going to apply that to a particular example. So here is the example. We are going to assume that we roll a die infinitely often, and we are going to call xn the sum of the first n rolls. And the goal is to find the probability that this sum of the first n rolls is a multiple of some given integer m at equilibrium. And also, for technical reasons, we are going to assume that this integer m is larger or equal to 6. So first, I'm going to prove a general theorem about doubly stochastic Markov chain. So the theorem says the following. So assume that we have a Markov chain, a discrete-time Markov chain, whose transition matrix is doubly stochastic. So assume that P is doubly stochastic. So again, this means that not only P is stochastic, but also P transpose is stochastic. So we said that P is stochastic if the sum of all the coefficients on each row is equal to 1. And this is always the case for a transition matrix. Now doubly stochastic means that the same is true if you look at the columns. So if you look at the sum of all the coefficients along any given column, the result is again 1. So that's what we mean by doubly stochastic. And if we have this assumption, okay, then you can prove that this distribution pi, which is equal to the uniform distribution on the state space S. And so for this result, we also need to assume that S is finite, because the uniform distribution can only be defined on a finite set or an infinite uncountable set also, but not on an infinite countable set. So we just assume that S is finite in this case. Then it turns out that this specific distribution is stationary. And so the proof is pretty simple. The idea is just to check that indeed the system pi p equals pi, I mean, the goal is in fact just to prove that this specific choice for pi indeed is a solution to the system pi p equals pi. And so the idea is just to observe that if you multiply the vector with only one coordinate with the matrix P, so I'm going to show you here in the picture. So here, for instance, you have the coefficient of the matrix P, and then if you multiply by the vector with only once, then the effect of multiplying on the left by this vector is just to basically look at 1 times this coefficient plus 1 times this coefficient and so on. And so here you end up with exactly the sum of the coefficients of the first column of the matrix. But because we assume that the matrix is doubly stochastic, the sum is 1. Okay? Same for every column. And so eventually this shows that indeed the vector with only coordinates is indeed an eigenvector for this matrix. And so we get that this is 1, 1, and so on. And so this tells you that the measure that puts mass 1 to each state is an invariant measure or a stationary measure. That's the same concept as stationary distribution, but extended to measure in general that are not always probability measure. Now to get now from this result, because you know that you have a linear system, you know that any vector that is proportional to this one will be a solution, but clearly pi is going to have, I mean the coordinates of pi are in fact going to be equal to 1 divided by the cardinal of S. Okay, and so this shows that indeed pi is proportional to this vector, and so should again be solution to this linear system. So this implies that pi p equals pi. So when you look at the uniform random variable on S, then you get a particular solution to this system. And we saw in a previous video that pi was stationary if and only if it satisfies this linear system. And so we are done with the proof. We proved that indeed pi is stationary. So now next step is to see how we can use this result to look at the fraction or the probability that our sum of the first n rolls of a fair die is going to be a multiple of n. So I remind you that in our problem xn is equal to the sum of the first n rolls of the die. Okay, so if you look at this process, so you see that you start at x0 equals 0, okay, you have an empty sum that's 0, then x1 is going to be the value of the first die, so that's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. Each of those values will have probability 1 or 6. And then you keep going and so on. So for this process, the state space here is going to be the set of all the possible natural numbers. And you see that each state is its own communication class, and all those communication classes are open because you always jump outside of those classes. And so it's easy to see that Xn is in fact transient. And that's not really the best, so that's a Markov chain, but that's not really a convenient process to look at to study the probability that Xn is a multiple of n. But something natural to define is just a new process Yn that is going to be Xn but modulo n, okay? So eventually, so if I define this new process Yn, which is Xn but modulo n, okay? So because Xn is Markov, it's easy to see that Yn again is Markov, okay? That's just a function of Xn. So again, this means that Xn plus 1 only depends on Xn and not on the past. Similarly, Yn plus 1 is only going to depend on Yn and not on the past. So Yn is again a Markov chain, but now the new state space becomes something smaller, 0, 1, and so on, and you go up to m minus 1. That's the new state space, and you can think of this as a process moving on a circle. Okay, so from your infinite half line, now you move on a circle. So let's say you have 0 here, 1, 2, and so on, and you go up to m minus 1, so you have m state total, and then we want to study basically we want to find the stationary distribution of this process. If we find the stationary distribution of this process, we can see the probability at equilibrium that yn is equal to 0, but you see that yn equals 0 is the same as saying that xn is a multiple of m. Okay, that's why we introduce this process. Because the event we want to study is exactly, in fact, the event that yn equals zero. So what we want to find is basically the probability that yn equals zero at equilibrium. Okay? And for that, what we want to do is basically find the equilibrium and find the value of pi zero. If we call this equilibrium pi, what is the value of pi zero? And so in this case, I'm able to, in fact, solve the problem without even writing any transition matrix. That's very convenient, just by drawing a feature. So if you look at the process itself, so I'm going to add a few more states here. I'm going to add a few more values. If you look at your process, it turns out that from any state, you can go to any of the next six states. So let's say from two, you can go to three or four and so on. So I have one, two, three, four, five, I need one more, six arrows. So from any state, you can go to any of the next six states. So be careful by what I mean by next, because the next state after m minus one is going to be zero. Okay, you are now turning on a circle. But then from any state, you can go to any of the other, any of the next six states with equal probability. So now you see also that from this picture, it's clear also that from, for instance, if you look at all the possible states that lead to this one, okay, you are going to have, you can go from two to be, to this one, but from one also, or from zero, or from basically any of the six previous values. Okay, so same story. If I, for instance, fix a state here, I'm going to add a few more again. Then what you obtain is that you can go from this one to that one, this one to that one, and so on. So I have 4, 5, and 6. So from any of the previous 6 states, you are going to jump to this one, each with probability 1 over 6. And so this means that indeed, the sum of, if you look at the flow out of a state, that's a sum of 6 numbers all equal to 1 over 6, okay, which makes sense, they add up to one, that's normal because we have a stochastic process. But this works also if instead you look at the flow going in a state. Okay? If you look at all the ways you can jump to this state from the previous state, it's you can jump to this state from any of the six previous states, and each with probability 1 over 6. So again, the flow in also add up to one, the flow out add up to one, but the flow in also add up to one. And just with this feature, well, this means that your process should be doubly stochastic, okay? Here you look at the sum of all the coefficients on the same row, looking at everything going to a state, you look at the sum of all the coefficients on the same column. And so from this feature, we deduce that P is doubly stochastic. And so from our previous theorem, the fact that if P is doubly stochastic, then the uniform distribution on the state space should be stationary, we deduce that okay, pi, which is equal to, so the uniform distribution in this case, because you have m state total, is going to be the constant vector with coordinate only 1 over n. This one is solution to the system pi p equals pi, so it is stationary. Okay, so because it's stationary, you can deduce that this probability at equilibrium is just pi zero. Okay, pi is the equilibrium, and you know that pi zero is equal to 1 over m. So we deduce that at equilibrium, the probability that while n equals 0, which is the same as the probability that xn is a multiple of n, is going to be equal to 1 over m. So I can write this as a conclusion. So our conclusion is that that the probability that xn is a multiple of n is equal to 1 over m. And that completes the proof for this problem. So one more thing I should say, here I stay very vague when I state those results. I just say find this probability at equilibrium. But now, because we don't have yet all the tools, we need to study the actual convergence of the process. So we assume that we are already under one of the stationary distribution. But it turns out that in this case, because the process is irreducible, and we saw this notion, okay, it's clear that the process is irreducible. From any state, you can go to any other state in a finite number of steps. So the process is irreducible. It turns out that also because the state space is finite, we see that this implies that the process is also positive recurrent. And from those two ingredients, irreducibility and positive recurrence, you can deduce that there is a unique stationary distribution. Because we have one which is the uniform distribution, in fact, we can say a little bit more than our conclusion here. We can say that that the only stationary distribution is this uniform distribution on the state space. And even better than that, we can say that in fact, starting from, well, it's not starting from any state here, we start really from x0 equals 0, but starting from x0 equals 0, we are going to have eventually that the fraction of time your sum here is a multiple of m is also going to be equal to 1 over m. So that's not just something that we see at equilibrium, that's something that we see eventually because we have indeed convergence to this unique equilibrium, unique stationary distribution. So I'm done for today's lecture, and in the next video, I'm going to look instead at symmetric random walk on a finite connected graph to give you an illustration of how to use this notion of time reversibility.